alone while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me falling, but he bids me go through the voice of hope. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Thank you for allowing me to come to your home through this media. Due to the coronavirus, we are not able to worship in our sanctuary today. But God's worship does not stop as we gather in the homes and in our personal places of prayer to glorify God. Today's message comes from book of Exodus, chapter 17, 1 through 7. The title for our meditation is, God is our unfailing source of life. I would like to share a brief meditation on this passage. It was the presence of the Lord that gave Moses the strength and confidence he needed to lead the people of Israel. He had a difficult task of leading 2 million people who were former slaves and was trying to build them into a nation to God. He was able to persevere because the Lord was with him. Although we see God's presence with the Israelites through the clouds by day and pillar of fire by night, he also allowed the people to go through difficult situations to help build their faith and trust in him. The purpose of the Lord's leading is to help us to grow in faith, in the knowledge of God, in godly character. The children of Israel have left the land of Egypt and are on their way to the promised land through wilderness. As they journey in the wilderness, they thirst for water, and once again they begin to murmur. Every time they had a need, they started complaining. One thing we should remember, that our life's journey involves much more than reaching a destination. It involves opportunities to grow in faith and in the knowledge of God, and also to form a godly character. Israelites had a long way to go before they could become a nation. Each new trial they faced on their way brought out the worst in them. When they came to Rephidim in the wilderness, they again found themselves without water. They began to complain and find fault with Moses, even though God had proven to them by providing water and food, yet they began to quarrel with Moses. Why? Because their hearts were still in Egypt. They were guilty of ingratitude and unbelief. They were wanting to go back to the old life, and as a result, they again failed to pass the test that God had brought to them in the wilderness. One thing we need to remember, in every difficult situation God allows us to go through, we either become a better or a worse person because of it. If we continue to complain and blame God, then we will be losing the opportunity to grow spiritually. But when we trust God and let Him have His way, the trial will work for us and help us to grow in His grace. When we are out of fellowship with God, angry and bitter, we will do crazy and unreasonable things. That is exactly what Israelites were planning to do. They wanted to stone their leader, Moses. Exodus 17, chapter 5th verse. What did Moses do? He called upon the Lord for help. In times of trouble, Moses counted on God. He trusted God and knew about God's sufficiency. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Psalm 46, 1. The Israelites had not learned that lesson. How unfortunate they were. The Lord told Moses to take some of the elders with him, plus the rod that symbolized God's power, Exodus chapter 7, 20th verse, and strike the rock in the sight of the people. When Moses struck the rock, as God told him, the water gushed forth from the rock and met the needs of the people and livestock. A gracious God met the needs of the complaining people. We see here the first mention of the rock and the water that came out of the rock. What does the rock represent here? The first thing that it represents is, the rock represents the pre-incarnate Christ. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 1 through 4 explained, I want you to know, brethren, that our fathers were all under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And all ate the same supernatural food, and all drank the same supernatural drink, for they drank from the supernatural rock which followed them, and the rock was Christ. The rock is a beautiful portrait of Jesus Christ. Psalm 61:2 says, Lead thou me to the rock that is higher than I, for thou art my refuge, a strong tower against the enemy. Then Peter also wrote, Behold, I lay foundation in Zion, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and he who believes in him will not be put to shame. 1 Peter 2, 6 through 8. It is one of the marvelous pictures of Jesus Christ as the foundation, the one upon whom we rest and the one upon whom the church is built. A rock is the last place we go for a drink of water. We cannot get even hard water from a rock. We can admire the rock's sterling qualities and durability. We can learn great lessons from it, but we cannot drink it. Jesus' life and teachings are like polished marbles which are engraved, and though we apply them to our life, they won't save us. We can fall on the rock Christ for salvation, but no human effort is able to get water from the rock. Only when the rock was struck by the rod, then it brings forth life-giving waters. Only when Jesus was crucified and died in our place and bore our sins on the cross, then we will be saved. The rock that was struck is the picture of the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. The second thing that comes out of this passage is, in the book of Numbers, chapter 20, 1 through 12, we are told a second time the children of Israelites complained that they had no water. The first time, when Israelites murmured about being thirsty, God told Moses to strike the rock and water gushed forth out of the rock and met the needs of the people and livestock. But the second time, God gives Moses a different kind of instructions. God tells him to take the rod and gather the people together and your brother and speak to the rock before their eyes, and it shall give forth water. Remember, God instructed him to speak to the rock, and you shall bring forth the water out of rock for them, so you shall give drink to the congregation and their cattle. And Moses took the rod before the Lord, as God had commanded him. After Moses had gathered the people together before the rock, and he said to them, "Hear now, you rebels, shall we gather forth water for you out of this rock?" And Moses lifted up his hand and struck the rock with his rods twice, and water came forth abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their cattle too. And the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, "Because you did not believe in me to sanctify me in the eyes of the people of Israel, therefore you shall not bring these people into the land which I have given them." Moses was denied entry into the promised land. Why? Because Moses, instead of speaking to the rock, he struck the rock second time. This rock was already struck. That means Christ was crucified 2,000 years ago. And when he hung on the cross and said, "It is finished," it is indeed finished. It is accomplished. Christ does not have to be crucified again and again. God is satisfied with what Jesus Christ did for us on the cross. The question is, are you satisfied with the work Christ has done for you and me on the cross? He died to save you and me. All that God is asking us is to believe in His Son, Jesus Christ. How many times we have complained about our circumstances and failed to trust God. We have the living waters of blessings come to relieve our distress and disappointments. All we need is to say, "Not my will, but thine will be done. Come to him in faith. May your stay for these 2 weeks be a blessing at home and with your family. And God bless you and keep you safe. I just leave you with this prayer. Ever present God, even as you are present with us this day, we yearn to feel your presence in our midst each and every day of our lives. Love us into faithful living. Wash over us with your grace. Nourish us with the waters of your presence and lead to eternal life. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.